This podcast is brought to you by the School of Advanced Study, University of London.
It will not have read it, of course. Have you had a chance to look at any of it at all?
No.
No, but you can get it for next time, that's fine. I can. I didn't see you that you brought to me before already, but we discussed another text that contained some of these things before, but anyway, you just see what you can pick up and then talk about it afterwards. Maybe we should start with what the goals are. What the goals are of this whole project. You know, this slightly strange title, Philosophical Theory of Everything. And the two demands, or the two criteria of maybe three, of comprehensiveness and coherence and intelligibility, because it's quite a project. There are quite a few terms introduced. So what is a philosophical theory of everything? What did you think about that idea? Do you have anything to say about it?
Well, there are many angles to look at, or we rephrase it, or look at it from different angles. What about the systematicity, how things all hang together? Which results in a holistic theory, but on being of everything, it's on the scope of the theory, as well, because it claims to itself the status of science, claims for philosophy the status of science. The sciences were of restricted discourse, but this theory is unlimited or universal.
Yeah, exactly. So that's very important with these
discourse.
What he calls the unrestricted universe of discourse.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And there's one aspect to it that's different, which comes into his theoretical frameworks. That is a theory where it combines everything is aspects of being, so everything is into being. So, and being reveals itself into facting, and these factings are expressible by sentences which have as a content, a semantic content, which is the proposition. So it's, for him, it seems that there is no division between thoughts and reality when it comes to truth and knowledge and even beauty and even moral action, because it's all kinds of factings, and factings are revelation or manifestation of being.
Yeah.
So language is a manifestation of being.
Exactly.
Acting in the world is a manifestation.
Everything is a manifestation of being. You know, that's all the same thing everything is, but there's certainly the idea that and that's maybe that's a place to start, because that's something that for many of us today is quite an unusual thought, that a being is intelligible. So going back into the history of thought, you know, Parmenides already says being and thinking are the same. Heidegger has written a lot about that sentence. Being and thinking are the same. And there is a, 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 there is a way in which a scholarly history of philosophy would say that's idealism. And you find something similar, and you could say that Hegel's logic is also the idea that somehow being and thinking are the same. And also in medieval philosophy, which I think is always important in this project, Thomas Aquinas also is like an Aristotelian realist, and Aristotle is the same, saying knowledge is of being. So the whole question that has become so dominant in certain corners of modern philosophy, how can we know the real? That is, certainly for almost you might say a pre-critical tradition in philosophy, is not a question. Of course you know the real, because knowing is of the real, and that's what knowing is. And there might be limits to our knowledge, or our knowledge is imperfect or whatever, but this question of how do I even get to what is outside of my own representations, that question does not even arise. And in a way that has to do with the fact that there is a non-representational view of what knowledge is here that goes back to before Descartes, because Descartes does start with this question, how can I know that what I see around me is real and not just in my head? That question is not being asked here. And that's a very fundamental point, because this old idea that being and thinking are somehow one, or that being is intelligible in and of itself, that can be and has been, I think, constructed or interpreted in many different ways in the history of philosophy. And I would like to suggest that there is a kind of bottom root meaning to it, or that comes back time and time again and can be conceptualized in different ways. Parmenides is maybe one way which starts to be conceptualized, and certainly the critical project is another way, the skeptical tradition is another way, but there's also a metaphysical ontological way in which it can do that. And he says himself about it, maybe that is interesting, but not to look at it quickly. Let me just quickly find it. He says that if this weren't the case, where is that example? So he gives a kind of a reductio ad absurdum of the opposite view. He says if that weren't the case, our lives would be completely mysterious.
Oh yeah, by the conference.
By the conference, yeah. Where is that?
It's on truth.
On truth, isn't it? Yeah, the final, it's in the chapter on truth there, right at the end, isn't it?
Yeah. This is page 58.
So he says on page 58, yeah. Being's intrinsic expressibility can also be clarified as follows. The SSP, the structural system of philosophy, accepts as a matter of empirical fact that human beings, by thinking and speaking about being, or more loosely about reality or the world, engage with being in ways that exhibit high degrees of success. The SSP also accepts, as included in the best explanation of this success, that human beings attain it precisely by articulating being in its intrinsic expressibility. So we have to ask ourselves, why is that the best explanation of this success? Hence, that language and linguistically expressible thinking and being coincide precisely in articulation. To clarify by means of an example, one who denied that the attendees of the 2012 meeting of the Metaphysical Society of America had succeeded in assimilating facts about being, indeed, according to the SSP, factings constituting being, as they read announcements about the meeting, made inquiries, arrangements for transportation, and interpreted visual and auditory data provided by clocks of various sorts, would appear to have no better option than to classify the presence of those attendees at the meeting as resulting from an enormous number of inexplicable miracles. the SSP defends its explanation as superior. He then says, oh, that's maybe the one joke in the whole book. So that's why he very clearly says, you know, you have to assume that being is intelligible, otherwise how can you even make sense of things like people showing up at an agreed point in time?
That could take us back to the point about tentability. Because to me it's more nervous than analytical history, on truth and on ethics and beauty.
Yeah.
Because what he's saying is that if you take Tamsky formula, in the form he presented it, the T schema or Field's presentation of it, you're still within language. So you're not connected to reality.
No, that's right.
And he presents his framework, theoretical framework, as to connect with beings, so it connects with reality. So he's more real, really, than those people who stay within the sphere of the sentence, logically, whether it's correct or not, or whether we get to truth just by discussing components of language. And when you discuss ethics, values, the aesthetic, the beauty, colorology, whatever he calls, then he thinks that the world could be beautiful in itself without there are human beings around. Because even in itself, it has that capacity which it will activate if human beings are around.
That's right, yeah. So there is something about being itself. Yeah, that's right. I mean, I think it goes back, and that's certainly not an analytical theme, that being has to be thought of as, in some sense, an active agency, as something that does. That, you know, also, as I suggested last time, there is a kind of abundance in being. Being communicates itself to everything.
Yeah.
So you're saying that being is intelligible despite human being?
What do you mean?
Well, you just said that
beauty.
Beauty.
Yeah. It has that
could
chronological beauty, which is as a capacity, which will be activated if there are human beings. It gives them chronological pleasure.
Yeah.
But if you know, we're talking about being and thinking being the same. Is it Parmenides? Why it's not saying that being is thinking, he's saying that thinking is of being. Is it not? Is it thinking is
he's not saying thinking is being.
No, he's saying thinking is a manifestation of being.
Yeah.
Through that manifestation of being, we can come to know being, perhaps.
Yeah.
It's our route to it. But I don't know, just from what you said of beauty, it just seemed to me that.
Sorry. This part of your objection is that I thought about it, because if he thinks being is thinking, then it becomes conceptual, where he puts action before concepts.
Yeah.
So he doesn't want to say that.
He certainly doesn't want to say that being is conceptual.
Yeah.
And I don't know how clear he is about it. I will have to see that when we get to the chapter, Gundel's chapter on Heidegger. Hopefully we'll come clear there. I'm thinking about whether he would feel that even language has to be ultimately sort of rational or conceptual. I don't know. Because you could say, if language and being coincide in articulation, but there are no limits to be put in advance to what can be articulated. So we don't know, I mean, there's no point in saying this is a real articulation and this isn't a real articulation. You could only think of a pragmatic criterion in ways. So language can mean anything. Yeah, you don't know where the limits are to what can be said. You know, remember last time we looked at this Wittgenstein quote, "The limits of my world, the limits of my language are the limits of my world." I think from this analysis, it would follow that there's no way of even saying what the limits of my language are. In a way, every fact thing that might come our way will be expressible in a certain way. You don't even have to assume that
the principle of non-contradiction would have an unlimited validity.
He introduced the idea that human beings are extensively coexistent, are coextensive with being.
Yeah.
So that's the idea that thought and beings are one, which is, I think, is he says somewhere that like human beings like a privileged position,
because
they can express being.
That's right. It does seem to say that. Does that relate to your point about?
Thinking and language is a manifestation of being, like a bird or a tree, but it's we have the privilege of being able to kind of re-articulate it.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. What would you think of that?
That's what I find in the. You find in Fichte as well about the empirical I and then the absolute. Well, there's the absolute I and empirical I and nature.
Mm-hmm.
We convert nature, so we sort of speak for it.
Yeah.
Or convert it back into the. So the nature itself will reveal being through us, or it comes back to being through us, or being will integrate everything within it through us.
Yeah, that's right. So that's a very old idea that human being not there's very often also to include. You see how this is a very classical theme.
Yeah.
And there's also in today's philosophy there's very often this misunderstanding that philosophy, that philosophical tradition were to say the human being is somehow better than everything else or something like that. Or that's not the point here. The point is that it is of the nature of what it means to be a human being, that you have a relation to all of being, and that human being can become the place where the whole of being can somehow become present to itself. Schelling says this clearly, that in man, nature opens its eyes and looks at itself, and Fichte to get it, and
Schopenhauer, you get the...
Schopenhauer is very clearly the
subject of will, and the subject of knowledge.
Yeah.
And then subject of knowledge gets clever.
Yeah.
And figure out the whole scheme.
Yeah. So he said there is this root of knowledge and this root of the will, and they go apart in evolution, and then in man they suddenly meet each other again. And knowledge stands eye to eye with will.
Yeah.
And then at first with the will.
Will.
Yeah.
Will.
The will. And that's a shock, you know. So he describes this as a kind of whoops, where did I see you before? And then this whole mediation in which knowledge becomes the Weltauge, the eye of the world, and there's a kind of redemption in that as well. And so it doesn't mean at all. And in Heidegger you have the same thing, where Heidegger says man is the shepherd of being. You know, that's the or Dasein is the shape of being, the structure of existence is Dasein. Dasein is the structure of being, but the human being could well lose this position of being Dasein, of being the place where being arrives. There's no guarantee that the human being will remain that. If we become robotic cyborgs or we make ourselves into that, then we will have lost this position of being the shape of being. And for Alan White and for Puntel, I think there is a direct line to Aristotle's remark in De Anima, Book 3, where Aristotle says the human mind is to a certain extent, or in a certain sense, all things. And that's in medieval philosophy, it was a standard phrase, mens humana est corpore omnia. The human mind is in service to a certain extent all things. Indicating in Aristotle very early realization, again, of this unlimitability. We cannot in advance limit our own thinking, because we would have to be, in order to put a limit, we have to be on the other side of it as well, because otherwise we couldn't put it. So there is a kind of inherent universality to
to the human mind,
yeah,
and therefore to language.
Yeah. Although it requires some kind of endeavor to reach that point of language or of thought.
Yeah.
It doesn't come immediately.
No, it doesn't come immediately, and it also doesn't mean that we have it in our hands and that we can claim absolute knowledge. So what this relation is in that we have to all things. Yeah. You know, like you already said, for Fichte it's a kind of regulative idea. For Hegel it becomes a real possession, a Wissenschaft, a science. We've got it in our hands.
As a mysticism.
Yeah,
idea
in Schopenhauer it's kind of more like a mystical thing.
Benjamin talks about in his article on language, or language as such, and the language of man. And he thinks that there's everything in the universe have language. It's only a human being could articulate that and could talk for.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, pure language. Yeah, that's right. Even the stones.
Yeah,
I think it's a beautiful idea.
Yeah.
And it's, So what is it here? What is it in the structural systematic philosophy? What is our orientation to this universality? How does he figure it?
Because it's activity, being is activity, so facting or...
Yeah, but let's start on the human side.
Oh, okay.
So what...
Would it be a language that expresses propositions with that which are related to the ontological aspects, which is facting in the world?
Are you asking what Weiss' orientation to universality is in terms of this liberation that you spoke at the beginning?
Well, I'd like to make it very technical.
Okay.
What is in the structure of this philosophy, but how does this universal aspect, this, the human mind is in a certain way all things, or intelligibility and facting and being coincide, how does that translate into a theoretical structure? Here. So that's the point of it. You know, I'm trying to. So
yeah,
I think what you said. So Benjamin says somewhere, like what you said, all things have language, and if we could just hear it and become translators of all things, then that's what we are. Yeah? And that's a very poetical, rich, mystical image. What is that? What is that in this theory? Is it there, or is it?
Well, one thing I said is, you know, we are being coextensive with being.
Yeah. But why?
That, I suppose because we have the language.
Yeah. So I think it's important to maybe to see that this notion of theoretical framework is really central here.
Mm. Is it something about structural systematic philosophy that places such an emphasis on language, and are you saying that it's something about the method that places such an emphasis on language, and why do they do that? Is it an assumption that language is such an important thing in terms of being?
That's the assumption, and the question is indeed, so why, how in the methodology is that the purchase of it in terms of the methodology of this structural systematic philosophy? Yeah.
It's difficult because if you're looking at concepts, you're obviously making an assumption that language is important because we need it to look at concepts.
Yeah.
So, and especially in analytic philosophy, I don't know how we would say language isn't so important. And of course, animals are at the same level as us. I don't know how we would do that.
Yeah, go on. What's your point?
It's tricky. I guess I'm kind of coming from a feminist perspective a little bit in terms of, the rational and, emphasizing language and the type of language we use to talk about these things and how we don't include other aspects of it.
Yeah, okay, sure. Yeah. And here there is if you will, there is, let's say, there is no reference to any of this other thing, of these other things. There is no talk of embodiment or whatever, or anything like that. And in analytical philosophy, it's the same thing. Yet there is here certainly a claim that there is, that there's more than an analytical philosophy. It's not just, well, we talked about sort of conceptual, which I think is a very difficult term here. It's not just a conceptual analysis. It does try to put us in touch with the sense of what articulation is or what expression is. That has an ontological component. It's not just about representations. So you can't say that these propositions, these topics, talk about the structure of the proposition in a minute, but you can't say that these propositions, so that the AS is these factings and then these propositionings, which are sort of the mirror aspect of it, two sides of the same coin. They are not simply conceptual structures, they're not simply subject predicate structures, they're more than that, or something else.
I think one of the aspects that gives it universality is the change of language, conceptually, from talking about substances and things into ontology of facting, where anything in the world, even values, or values whether it is moral or aesthetic, become facting in the world. Where science wouldn't deal with these, or the specific sciences wouldn't deal with these values, there's no room for it. And also analytical philosophy and philosophy as it's being done, and the ordinary language doesn't deal with this because it's always geared towards things and substances. Well, this could give it more universality by including things which are not included in the...
That's right. There's no limit to what can be spoken about.
Yeah.
And there is a process, I think there's a process ontology behind it. In fact, there's processes. They can be anything. It doesn't, there's no prior limitation to it. But what about this notion of theoretical framework? What is that? What does that mean here? I think it's an important point. It's important to understand what, because he's almost carving out a position for philosophy that is different from what it has been. But it again, it is a motive of purification in it. It's almost as if he's saying it's only now that we can really see what the core business of philosophy, or this kind of philosophy, it's just a word, but what one of the core businesses of philosophy is. And this has to do, I think, with what a theoretical framework is. That phrase, theoretical framework, makes me always very itchy, because it comes from Carnap, who uses it. It's the first time to use it. And I think it's like a suspicious term, because it means that there will be some sort of, like a frame, and you have to stay within it, and then you can theorize, or you can look at things and get a representation of it. And if you step outside of the frame, then will your words lose meaning. So
I thought about it, because after reading the book, I thought, after all, what's this framework he's talking about?
Yeah.
And he seems to be characterizing it more than giving a definition, single definition, in the chapter. And it seems to be the whole theory, that you've got a theory, so you've got a theoretical framework, which is almost your theory, and and how to make this diet by being holistic. And then you have a family of these conceptions, and then you have matter framework where you could compare these, and you could adjust your framework as well, but not to the limit that you alter it. But to me, I think it's the basic idea, because it's like the Weltanschauung. You have to have a view. And I think, if you like, the primacy of being, and how to articulate being, and that being articulates itself through fact, which is expressible by the semantic content, which are propositions expressed by sentences.
So there is you could say there is a thing like a theoretical framework.
Yeah.
We have theoretical frameworks. If we do research, you know, like especially if you know if you're writing, you know, the first thing that you have to do is that your supervisor will ask, so what is your conceptual framework? A frame is something that you can hang something on, or that you can look through, or you can put something in. And theory is visioning, watching, seeing. That's from the word for the see. So there is a theoretical framework, and then you said also worldview, Weltanschauung. That is the same sort of thing. There is a kind of view of the world, a perspective on things. So is a theoretical framework a perspective on things? Apart from anything else, that would open up immediately the Heideggerian problem. Think of the text that the Die Zeit des Weltbildes, that Heidegger says we live in the age of the worldview, and that's a kind of representational thinking. There is this object, and we have a certain perspective on it, and that leads to all these conundrums of modern philosophy. So that's already the difficult one. And then, so we have worldview, the framework, and then we also have method. A method is maybe something else than a theoretical framework. Or maybe it's not. Maybe it is related to it.
Can I just...
Yeah.
So, you know, we're almost saying that one has to frame the view or limit the view in order to reach what is unlimited.
Exactly, yes, that's right. He says that literally, doesn't he? He says, yeah, go on.
No, that's just...
It's a very good point. He says that the structural systematic philosophy turns around the perspective that we normally find, that would say theoretical frameworks are limitations, and it turns it makes it into a virtue by saying, no, it's only because you have a framework that you can have a theory at all. And of course the theory is going to be limited, but without a framework you can't have a theory. Why wouldn't you then simply say, well, you don't, so that's just a theory then? Well, why do you call it a framework? Well, I don't know if that's a coherent argument, but there are principles that he uses to explain what a theoretical framework is. Maybe we should have a look at those. As on paragraph 2-3. So he says there are seven central theses.
Sorry, what page?
It starts on page 24.
Thank you.
Maybe you can have a look. So there you get the seven theses. He's first said that, let me just read this out to you very quickly on page 18. One point of central importance that recurs in various forms throughout his book is the following. Although it is common to consider such things as standpoints, perspectives, and even languages as limiting or restricting theoretical inquiry, theoretical frameworks, which is just indicated, include languages, make subject matters available to theoretical inquiry. And so that's important. Also, the idea that whole languages are theoretical frameworks. So if you think, for example, you just mentioned feminism, if you think of feminism as, well, it's a political project, but it's also a conceptual theoretical project, or it's maybe even a language, then you could say that is a theoretical framework. Or you could think about it as a theoretical framework, which allows you to, as he said, make certain subject matters available to theoretical inquiry. And the question then becomes, okay, there are all sorts of theoretical frameworks, so there's no limit to them, and our daily language, our normal ordinary language is a theoretical framework, so just as a specialized, let's say, particle physics theory or whatever is a theoretical framework. What can we say, and that would then be a specific question for philosophy, what can we say about the nature of theoretical frameworks? Is there a theoretical framework of theoretical frameworks? Is there something that we can say, that's what he calls the unrestricted universe of discourse, something that does not single out a limited area of the world and reality or experience being in the last instance to articulate, but that somehow articulates being itself, being as such. That is the way that we begin to see how in this project the question of being is reformulated along these lines of the theoretical framework. So, and my question to Alan was, yeah, but that's then no longer a theoretical framework, because a framework is something that there must be also something else, you can't. Yeah, well, that's, we haven't solved that yet. But
so is it about stuff that you don't include rather than?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
it seems to me like
the framework is defined by what is not included in it, in a way.
I guess it's tricky because there's some things that you can't explain in this systematic kind of way with such concepts that are so strict. I think that, and then that's problematic in itself because you're just avoiding things that can't be explained in that way, which could be useful.
So how, yeah, like what?
What you said about, you know, not involving things like poetry and things like that.
Yeah.
Because those are the ways in which you can explain things that can't be explained in this sort of way.
And how do we know that that's, yeah, exactly. So a poem could not be considered to be a theoretical framework, or could it? We'd have to see.
Mm-hmm.
So, but that's a good point. Yeah, that's all. And there's also not the idea that philosophy should explain everything. Although it's called towards a philosophical theory of everything, that I think has to be taken in a very specific sense. It is also a sense of cleaning up. It's a sense of saying there are lots of things. Poetry has got its own thing, and so does physics and economics and whatever, and all these things which used to be maybe at one point part of philosophy, they can now be let go of. But there's something that remains and becomes ever clearer what it is that remains, and that is the theory of everything. But it does self-consciously limit itself right from the start to saying we're doing, this is a theory and not something else. And the question, that's really the whole background question, is that adequate to the question of being or not? And the suggestion by Puntel is certainly yes, it is. Heidegger tried to make it into something that it wasn't. We have to get it back to this. But this is our question. So that's so after he's made that point clear about the fact that the theoretical framework makes something available to theoretical inquiry rather than that it would be a limit or something. That point gets, as it were, the sting is taken out of the point of limiting. And the point that is made is that the theoretical framework enables. How can he be so happy as a child in a meadow, as it were, with the fact that these theoretical frameworks enable things rather than limit them? It's because he already has his metaphysical backing, I would say, of the fact that all expression is expression of being. All intelligibility is intelligibility of being. So a theoretical framework makes something available to theoretical inquiry, but it does so on this underground, this against this background, in which there is no, we're not disengaged from being as a whole when we develop a theoretical framework. It's much rather the other way around. It's only because we realize that we have this relation to being as a whole that we can be free to engage in specific theoretical projects, as it were. Whereas if we were to limit our understanding of what a theory is, or how our relation to the real functions, as simply that of a theory in terms of perspective, then we always have this anxiety within us, which is the anxiety of modern philosophy, like, how do we know our perspectives are adequate? How do we know that there isn't another perspective? Or you have your perspective, I have my perspective. That whole anxiety disappears here, because there is underneath it a theory of everything, the philosophical theory of everything.
I think actually, my view, that is as a framework. The rest of it, we're going to read these seven theses, the specific theories or axioms of the theory.
Yeah.
Something to be interested within the theory, which is that which you said is underlying everything, is that this theory of being.
Okay, let's keep that point in mind. So, that's how we have to understand that theoretical framework makes subject matter available to theoretical inquiry. Then he has a little section in which he says, okay, and by the way, we should not understand theoretical frameworks in any sort of foundational logic. So he says that's just a metaphor of thought, that there will be foundations, which is the theory of everything, and then on top of that you build your specific theoretical frameworks. No, that's not the case, because theoretical frameworks are just articulations of being. And I think you could put it like that very quick, if you want to put it in sort of concise terms. And there's no way to know what it might become or be, or you know, whatever theoretical frameworks that we might want to develop or that present themselves to us. So you have to. So it's not like a house where you start with the foundations and you build it up. No, it's more like a free-flowing structure, like the European Space Station, I think he mentions that.
Yeah.
So where it's just floating in a, there's no gravity, it's not being pulled down by anything, and you just bolt on new sections when you need them, and there's no supporting structure. The stability of our knowledge over various theoretical frameworks is created by the structure itself. It's not because it stands on solid ground, but it is because the structure itself is either more shaky or less shaky. And that applies within a theoretical framework, where we try to stabilize. So one of the epistemic operations that we are engaged in, that we call producing knowledge, is stabilize theoretical frameworks, and to maybe also stabilize the relation between them. So there's a kind of coherentist definition of knowledge here. And that is enough. That is enough. And maybe you could say that the free flowing, the gravity-less surrounding environment, that is the in the metaphor, that is the theory of everything, in which our different theoretical endeavors just float. So it tries to get rid of this idea that there would be any purchase or any gain to be made in talking about foundations.
But the foundation itself is a framework, theoretical framework. Because you can, if you're a Cartesian, then that's your theoretical framework.
Is it? Yeah, exactly. Or is it poetry?
Well, we can, or let's say in Fichte's case, he's foundationalist.
Yeah.
He's looking for first principle.
Yeah.
And then he puts up whole structure of theory, actually, of being.
Yeah.
Rival theory of being, you can say.
Yeah.
but one that's foundations.
Yeah.
Here is the framework is, so there, what I'm saying is that the details of the theory are not exactly the framework. The concept of theoretical framework could apply equally to a holistic conception like his,
yeah,
or to a Fichtean one, foundationalist. Yeah, the thing comes from comparing them from meta,
okay, yeah,
point of view.
Yeah, okay, sure.
Meta framework, where a theoretical framework, where you could compare the two and say, well, that one doesn't really do the what's required of it, the foundationalist, but my theory is better and is more comprehensive and
absolutely
intelligible.
No, that's right, that's a very important point, I think, yeah. So that's right, there's no reason to say foundationalism isn't a theoretical framework.
Yeah.
It's just that the claim is that the stabilizing view rather than the foundation,
yeah,
view is better. Yeah. That's also what he literally,
yeah,
gives proof why the structural systematic philosophy can never be complete. We'll get to that in a minute. It's part of the framework, yeah?
Yeah.
It's part of the thesis on what the frameworks are. So you can never have a perfect, according to this, you can prove that you can never have a, almost like the,
yeah,
like the Gödel's incompleteness theorem. You can almost prove, that's what he claims, that, that this can never be a final project, final philosophy. But the claim is that it's better than everything else.
Oh, and that's how it gains its scientific character. Because with science, it's
yeah,
it's final.
Yeah.
He says it as well.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's open, and but he says you can fix it.
Yeah.
But if you fix it too much, you alter the theory.
Yeah, exactly.
You alter the framework.
Yeah. Yeah.
So when you fix it too much, what?
You alter the framework. Because there are elements within the framework.
Mm-hmm.
So this bit's not in the center, for example, you can fix it, you can change it. But there is a point in the center, in the structure. If you change that one, the whole thing changes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah. He also uses the famous analogy of Aristotle, like, and Carnap uses actually the very same analogy when he introduces this concept of the,
yeah,
framework of rebuilding a ship at sea.
Yeah.
And so he says, it's like theoretical development is like rebuilding a ship at sea. And there comes a point where all the planks will have been replaced, and then the question is it still the same shape,
yeah,
or not?
Mm.
Yeah.
I like it, the way he actually is so clever. He, when he talks about the ship being changed in the water, he thinks the water is still supporting it.
Yeah.
That's why he prefers the one in space.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
But my background in the first half of my life was a physicist, and I worked on aluminium.
Yeah,
my first team was on
the moon. Oh yeah, so building space,
yeah,
stations.
And,
yeah,
no, and I worked on almost pure aluminium. But if you work on alloys, then you start with one metal, then you add up, then you end up with a different metal, completely different metal.
Yeah.
So you add silver to something. Here, very minimum silver, and the other metals, no metal. Then it decreases as you increase the silver, and you end up with pure silver at the end,
yeah,
and pure,
yeah,
metal here,
yeah,
and in between is something in between.
That's very nice, that's a lovely analogy actually. I think that you have that a lot, yeah. And that's kind of almost, it's almost a bit like alchemy, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
That's what Flores walked into an alchemy class.
Yeah, exactly, yeah, yeah. We're trying to make pure silver out of aluminium, yeah. And well, we're certainly trying to do that, that's right. So okay, let's look at these theses. So this is all very important, yeah. let's look at the principles. Or what does he call them? He says seven of the SSP central theses concerning theoretical frameworks. Theses that is emphasized in 1.3 to 2 are in no way foundational. We know I've talked a bit about that. Are the following: TF1, theoretical framework thesis 1. True sentences are situated within theoretical frameworks. No true sentence without a theoretical framework, of which it is part. They cannot be situated beyond or outside any theoretical framework whatsoever, because, as indicated above in 2.1, they must linguistically express semantic contents, colloquially meanings, and must somehow qualify as true. In the terminology of the SSP, the language in which a true sentence is articulated, the semantic contents it expresses, and the way in which it qualifies as true are components of a theoretical framework. So, okay, what does that mean? What is the importance of this principle?
Perhaps put a lot of things in there.
Yeah.
One of them is the truth of the sentence is relevant. The intelligibility of the sentence is related to the framework, and the truth of the sentence is related to the framework. And since he's going to talk holistic conception, so the truth of the sentence can be somewhere outside this system. Sentences will be mutually supporting to each other. So the truth of it is within the system, within the framework.
So theoretical framework has components.
Yeah.
Yeah. One is language, the language in which a true sentence is articulated is part of the theoretical framework. Then the semantic content that is expressed, the propositions rather than the sentences. Yeah. The factings. Although the factings correspond to certain propositions. He speaks of propositionings, doesn't he?
Yeah.
We'll get to that. And then the way in which it qualifies as true. So that would also appear to be a kind of, you might call it in a local, like a regional or local truth theory that is part of a theoretical framework. Maybe you can say what he is suggesting is that these components always work together, and if they don't work together, then you can't have such a thing as a true sentence. So you can't just ask the question, you can never just, it's not a relative, again it's the same thing as with this point about perspectives not being limiting. It's not a relativization of the notion of a true sentence. Although it does say, true sentence is always relative to a theoretical framework. Doesn't make it any less true. Would you agree with that?
Oh, I would agree, because this framework if we go further than this page, is about being which is everywhere. Then it's not relative to this. To this frame, being this framework, but being a framework of being.
Mm-hmm.
That's why later on, in favor of correspondence theory, so that it's not just set of sentences, but these sentences express or reflect being or correspond to being. It's an identity thing.
Yeah, exactly. Well, yeah, that's right. We'll get to that in TF2, yeah? That's true. So what about the poem then? Could a poem qualify as a theoretical framework according to this TF1? Or is that a silly question?
No, it's not a silly question. It has to be, because it's a theory of everything, so it's got to include theory of poetry, for example.
Yeah, but I was thinking
of the sentence.
I was thinking of a single poem.
Yeah.
So think of a...
Only if you say it, being in the poem, because it seems to me that you could have a sentence and speak it.
Yeah.
If you don't understand that sentence within the framework, then it's not a true sentence or a true proposition.
Yeah.
sort of poem, you'd have to somehow be in the poem or understand the poem.
Yeah, you have to be in the poem, that's right.
You'd have to know the writer's framework, wouldn't you?
Yeah, you'd have to always be in frame.
Yeah. Yeah. But that's not the point of poetry, is it?
That's right. Is it?
It's
what,
about
is it?
Thinking your own framework.
Yeah.
Well, or understanding through your own conceptual scheme.
So if I understand a poem, like, let's say, if I shall I compare the two sons day, yeah, the poem problems. If I understand, well, what happens? What's that? How does that poem mean? Is that like this? Is it? You wouldn't, of course, say no. Well, okay, so you wouldn't, in a simple factual way, say the sentences are true or false. Shall I compare it to a summer's day? Are more lovely and more temperate? No, not true, actually. So we don't say that. But at the same time, I would say, now at the end of the poem, as long as men can breathe and eyes can see, so long as this gives life to thee. There is again, if you want to be really school masterly about it, you say there is a kind of metaphorical use of life, and the life of the person is transmitted to the life of the poem, and there's a kind of continuation there. And so you could say, yeah, in a metaphorical way, this poem expresses that the author is aware of the finitude of human existence and the fact that art can art is longer than life. But you could also say maybe there is a real truth in the poem that somehow comes through in a way that could not be said in any other way. Like it's not and so the which is a truth of a kind of expression of a feeling that the author the implied author has. But there may also be a real truth in the sense that life is somehow continuous, can be continuous between people and texts, for example, or something like that. Yeah? So there is seems to be in a poem a point, and maybe it's simply said by painting or music, that latches on to something that would find articulation in a theory of being at theoretical level. That would not be too far away from Bloch, who would also say, you know, we don't know what life is. We know what life is, but we don't know what it's got in store, as it were. So there might be, but does that mean that we could say the poem is a theoretical framework, is a perspective on whatever it is that it's a perspective on? Or is there no value in saying? I mean, does that take care of it? You had this question, mm-hmm. Yeah, what about all these other modes that tell us about the world and that are not conceptual?
Mm-hmm.
Within the framework, there are like subdivision of it, if you like, where you have the theoretical, the practical, and the kind of logical of aesthetic.
Yeah.
And he develops in a short chapter, the operators for what you call theoreticity, practicity, effectivity. And then that the poetry comes because it's a master, they're beautiful. As he developed this operator, it is as beautiful that human fact in the edge experienced the fact in that, and could be that's the poem. But what I, and he actually. I was going to say something, but he objected to it, but I'll deal with it. What he says first, he says that these three are irreducible, mutually irreducible.
So which were irreducible?
They're mutually irreducible.
Yeah.
So that you can't judge a poem by its theoretical content.
No.
So he wants the independence of the beautiful.
Yeah.
Chronology. So yeah. He said irreducible. I would go a little bit further than him and say the point you just said earlier, that it could be some content which you can deal with theoretically, beside experiential. It's not saying that the poet, the whole sort of point of the poem is that it's a state and a theory about being, which could be the opening of discussion about being.
Yeah.
And Heidegger learned a lot from Hölderlin,
Exactly.
from Nietzsche.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
But, that would be re-articulated.
Yeah,
exactly. It doesn't mean the poetry and philosophy are the same.
No.
But
yeah,
that's right. Yeah, that's a very good point. Yeah, actually. And that could well be an addition that we would have to make to the SSP as a whole. Because that's right. I think that he would not, well, we have to discuss the catalogy chapter as well in detail to find out, but that's a very good point, I made a note of that. And many philosophers have, of course, been interpreted, but and you could even, it doesn't have to be poetry, and the liberalism of SSP can be anything, it could be a milkshake or whatever, but anything can start this theory.
Yeah, is that scientific proof? I think he mentions it somewhere.
Yeah.
It has a beauty of itself.
Yeah.
I just explained to you some experiment. Do you think that that's beautiful? Or when you see it on a graph, it's beautiful.
Yeah, that's right.
We know looking as scientists, they're not looking at it as as a beautiful thing.
Yeah, but even scientists can look at it as beautiful.
Yeah.
We know that scientists often use perhaps does it look good or not as a kind of to get a hunch of whether it's going somewhere, Okay, good. Well, that's good. That's a lot of points there, yeah? True sentences are situated within theoretical frameworks. Number two, TF2, page 25. Being, which includes all that is, theoretically manifests itself, truly or genuinely reveals itself, within all adequately determined or determinable theoretical frameworks. Among such frameworks are tacitly presupposed and only vaguely determined frameworks that human beings rely on in their everyday lives when they are concerned with discovering and presenting truths, as for example when someone consults a newspaper in order to discover when the sun will rise the following morning and presents the truth thereby discovered by uttering an indicative sentence, perhaps sunrise tomorrow is at 4:33. What's the point here? Does it have a point? And what does adequately determined mean?
Does it be assessed within a certain way? So, for example, you want to see something, you check it from the newspaper or somewhere. Well, some frames you can't because it's so vast.
Yeah.
It's so determinable in a way, but maybe beyond your capacity at the moment.
Yeah. A theoretical framework can turn out to be wrong.
Yeah.
So adequately determined. Well, we don't know really what that means. When are you in a position to say, okay, now I know that being vertically manifests itself here? When I say sunrise tomorrow is at 4:33, I assume that I would be in a position to say that being has vertically manifested itself if indeed, Darsky, the sun rises at 4:33.
Yeah.
We get to the point that these truths are relative to that framework. But here, I think what is important to note is that if we take it seriously, then he is saying that. Let's say this is true. Sunrise tomorrow is at 4:33. That doesn't just say the sun will rise at 4:33 tomorrow. No, being theoretically manifests itself, and that's more than saying, oh, that means the sun rises at 4:33. It means that
I don't know to answer what it means, but it means more. That the Ukraine means more. But you haven't yet.
I thought it's like we said last week, like in the Russell and so on, the grammar and then the prepositional, the logical form that comes underneath.
Yes.
So you get this, you think in terms of being.
Yeah.
It's expressed by these words.
Yeah.
The sun rises.
Yeah.
I am going to London or something like that.
Yeah.
But from Oxford. But it's underneath that is facting of being.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And that and the suggestion is that is something in its own right. So it's not just so the this is a very sorry, I think a very difficult, complex, subtle point. Yes, the sun rises at 4:33. So actually that star and the Earth move in a certain way such that there is a sunrise here for us to see. What he's saying here is that, and that is how being is here at 4:33 in the morning. Being is such that sunrise tomorrow is at 4:33. Or as he will say in his words, it be being such that, that's what he says later.
Or is it not being to look into the paper to find out when the sunrise is?
I look into the paper to find out, and when I find out, and I say truly, sunrise tomorrow is at 4:33, then being theoretically manifests itself in this theoretical framework in which I say, in which I can formulate a true sentence, sunrise tomorrow is at 4:33. But the implication is that, I think, that doesn't just mean that sunrise is 4:33, it means it be being such, as he puts it in his terminology, it be being such that sunrise tomorrow is at 4:33. So being manifests itself as such. And that is something over and above. So he's playing here with the ontological difference. He's playing here with the ontic level, at which we can talk about suns and planets and moons and sunrises and specific hours of the day, etc., all these ontic determinations. And he's talking about the ontological level, which we're talking about being as such. And we have to, that's the whole long last chapter of the book, which we won't get to today. We have to find out what that is. But that's maybe what he's saying here. So the theoretical, maybe this links to the point that I raised earlier about the perspectives not being left to themselves. They are somehow lodged in an articulation or of being as a whole.
I was wondering about utilizing the word discover.
Yeah.
Because that gives more sort of active.
Yeah, that's right. How would you what would you say about it here?
As someone who said, consult a newspaper in order to discover when it's on.
Yeah.
It's not just to find out, it's not some fact that's there, it's to discover something active.
Yeah, and uses the EPs, it italicizes the word.
Yeah.
But why?
That's my question. So, as I said, I thought this was because of the active thing.
Yeah. It's because of the active thing, a framework is something that you do something with. And maybe also to say that the theoretical framework is here the practice of finding out and then presenting as true. And in this everyday context, there is an adequate practice in order to find out when the sun rises, and that is consulting a newspaper. Yeah, I think that's what he has in mind.
But it sounds so ridiculous. He picked such a ridiculous example. to look at the newspaper, consult the newspaper, rather than waiting to see and look outside.
Yeah.
Seems such a ridiculous thing to do. And you have, it has to be verified by the newspaper. You don't
but this is about
senses.
Tomorrow, so you can't look now.
I see, yeah.
Yeah,
sunlight's tomorrow.
It's about...
it's in the newspaper, they put it.
Yeah, it's about finding out when the sun will rise tomorrow. So you can't... there's no other observation that you can make. But I mean, you know, why would you have chosen this example?
Mm. Yeah? It kind of says something about human beings as well. In terms of being, like, what kind of beings we are, we look in the newspaper to find out when the sun will rise.
Yeah.
When that's such a natural thing, and we could have, you know, looked at the pattern ourselves, we're asking other people when the sun rise. It's like kind of super skeptical, I guess.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I think it's interesting. Yeah.
Reminds me of Kant as well when he says reading the newspaper is the modern man's prayer or something.
Yeah.
Did
he
say you're
that?
Right there. He said that, didn't he? Reading the newspaper is the modern man's prayer.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah.
I was going to just suggest Muslims a prayer. Because we have early morning one before sunrise, so I know every night. Because I wake up for it.
Ah, yes, exactly. Yeah. So, but he would then say, you have a different theoretical framework, or do you look in the newspaper? No.
Well, I've got a timetable, because it shifts every day a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
So, I've got to make sure that I exactly what times, because I'm leaving home here really early. 6:30 I left, so, but you know, when's the sunrise? When I put to the prayer. At the moment it's 5:30 because they change the clock.
Yeah. So, okay, so that would be, that's the same, in a way, the same example that he gives.
Yeah.
So you have there is a daily practice, whatever it is, and in this case it's, you have a timetable in which you can look up when a certain time of the day is that you have to do something. And that's a practice, it's an epistemic practice, and that's a theoretical framework.
And some people, because there's the formal prayer, but then afterwards you can say things, and say, مَرْحَبًا بِخَلْقِ اللَّهِ جَدِيدِ, welcome the new creation of God.
Yeah.
The new creation, the day as a new creation of God.
Yeah.
So it's being revealed in itself.
That's right, yeah, that's definitely being revealed in itself. That's right. You won't find that in the newspaper today. Yeah, that's right. And that's beautiful. I love that. Yeah. And Descartes did, I mean, you know, we often blame Descartes for these things, but Descartes, one of the implications of Descartes' ontology, which hardly anybody ever realizes, is that every moment the world, the whole universe, is created again, new, by God. Yeah. That follows from his man. He was aware of that.
And Mother Branch as well.
Okay, good. So yeah, so it is a bit of a, I think I definitely take the point that there is the example is telling in many different ways. But the important point, which is one that we will only be, I think, fully able to understand next week, is this point about being veridically manifesting itself. That is where the meaning of being lies, as opposed to being, so the onte level. Okay, then we get to number 3. All truths are relative to the theoretical framework within which they are situated. So then he gives the example like, sunrise tomorrow is 4:33 is not true within the framework of contemporary astronomy, where among the truths that are situated are that the sun is stable relative to the earth, and that the earth both rotates on its own axis and revolves around the sun. So, sunrise doesn't have a... Maybe he's implying that sunrise does not have any status within modern astronomy. Then he says the two frameworks can be compared within a meta-frame, encompassing both. The
Comparison is an explanation of why the Earth, although veridically revealing itself within the framework of astronomy as moving, also veridically appears within everyday frameworks as immobile. A consequence of this is that astronomers can non-problematically in their everyday lives speak of the sun as rising and setting, as can non-astronomers who know enough about contemporary astronomy to be heliocentrists. Yeah. As is suggested by the example of Earth and Sun, the fact that being vertically manifests and reveals itself within all theoretical frameworks does not lead to any crippling relativism. Okay, then we go to number four. So, all truths are relative to the theoretical frameworks in which they are situated. That follows almost, I would say, automatically from one already. Right? But it's an interesting point. Also interesting because Heidegger makes that point too about the sunrise, and saying that, and he introduces it as a fundamental problem, that as a kind of schizophrenic split that we cannot deal with. I think he sort of, Alan White suggests that it's not. We can know that we can have these two theoretical frameworks, but they're not contradicting each other. So Heidegger makes a big point of the fact that my experience of the sun rising and setting contradicts the astronomical knowledge. And I think the suggestion is that it doesn't.
Is that because Heidegger expects after Copernicus that we suddenly suddenly the appearance will change?
Yeah. So that we now know that we no longer live on the Earth, but that we live on a planet.
Yeah. But really knowing the essence of that appearance doesn't change the appearance.
Yeah, that's right. So there is a, so the question becomes, well, is it then an appearance that the sun rises? Is it an appearance that the sun rises? Or is that being veridically manifesting itself? It's still true that the sun rises. But you can see how maybe, look, Heidegger gives this example because he wants to say, or at least I think that what the old fascist wanted to say, is our relation to the Earth, or that he talks about the mode of being, and he says that there is a kind of a mode of being, or there was a mode of being, in which the human being belonged on the Earth, and the Earth was underneath him, and the sun rose up over the sky, the heaven, and the sun rose up over it, and it would be short-changing, that disclosure of being, if we were to say, if we think that it is the same as still having the appearance that the sun rises, these are not the same thing at all. So if you have already reduced everything to a theoretical framework, yeah, then there is no contradiction. Because then you can simply say, like your explanation was beginning to say, yeah, it appears to us, because we're so tiny, we're standing on this huge planet, and we don't notice its movement, so to us it appears as if it's a bit like you're in a moving train, you know. So it's just an illusion, but it's still real, because it's our appearance, and we can't really change it. We can't influence the way we see it, but we know that actually there's something else going on. And those are just two theoretical frameworks. So I think certainly from Heidegger's point of view, you would say, well, now you're missing what it was about sunrise. But what it was when there still were sunrises that he is talking about. Because he's talking about an ordering of Earth, Heaven, Sky, Sun, Man, which has disappeared, but a certain way of being that has disappeared. And here again, the suggestion is, well, that's over-dramatizing it. There is a veridical manifestation of being involved in the experience of sunrise, as well as in the heliocentric theory, or the heliocentric, you can't even call it, can you call it heliocentric theory and worldview? I don't know. I don't think so. It's not, you're not, doesn't provide a view of anything. But you don't have to. You don't have to say, see that there's this contradiction, and you can still say that in a real sense, which is not trivial, being manifests itself as sunrise, and being manifests itself as the Earth rotating around the sun and rotating around its axis.
Could you repeat the last bit a bit longer, please?
You could say, according to the structure of systematic philosophy, you can say that it is both true that sun rises and that and the heliocentric theory, just a contemporary astronomical explanation, they are both true. But they do, but there's also a non-trivial sense in which that means that they veridically manifest being. And what I was trying to say is that I think if you look at Heidegger's remarks about the sunrise, that he says, no, just by saying it is true that it still appears to us that the sun rises, we are not in the same position as when we were when the sun actually rose. Mm-hmm. It doesn't rise anymore. Just as you can't, you know, like my supervisor always gave this example, trying to sacrifice a goat today, you know, can't do it. Just can't. If we could go through the motion, but you can't, there's no way we can sacrifice a goat today. So again, the pathos here is, no, it's not like that. There is, if we think truly carefully about what being is, this ontological level over and above the ontic, then we can say, we can have our cake and eat it. I think maybe that is the way that, that's maybe an emotion that's present in this theory. That we can still have our theory of being, but we don't have to give up our theoretical frameworks. Yeah. Maybe, yeah. Maybe,
I think earlier about the newspaper, Pretty that he says to read the newspaper. But later on, he gives the example, on the chapter on beauty, he gives the example of rainbow over Scotland in the Highlands, and how he stopped the car and got out with his wife and two children,
yeah,
to watch the rainbow.
Yeah.
And the delight they had at it. So he's not too theoretical.
Oh, that's a good, yeah, where is that? I remember that, yeah. Can you, which page is that?
The beauty.
Oh, yeah, it's in the chapter on beauty, isn't it?
Yeah.
But then Nathaniel, you wrote to me and said it's strange that such a book in itself offers such little catalogical delight.
He covers himself on that, doesn't he?
Yeah.
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 I think the chapter, page 120, I think, or roughly. So it talks about the rainbow.
It's also the only chapter where he has kind of a poetic motto, huh? Toi man te oi kala pata.
What page is that?
To God all beautiful. But it's right, and I thought of that, and I thought, yes, here we have his iris. He calls an iris. That's the rainbow.
Color can delight and beauty.
Yeah, this is experience somewhere of of a rainbow.
Yeah. Page 16.
Very bourgeois example. 116.
116. An example not only clarified but stabilizes C1. Once driving through the Scottish Highlands with his family, he met the author.
He met himself, yeah?
The author saw through the car's windshield a particularly striking rainbow. He pulled off the road, as had several other drivers, and he, his wife, and his two children started stared at the rainbow. He, and according to their testimony, the members of the family, of his family, were chronologically delighted by it.
Yeah, so that's a very weird formulation, isn't it? He makes a point, I didn't really make a mess at the beginning, but he makes a point of the fact that the subject is removed from the philosophy, and he makes a point of that. He always talks, he always says it's not, and he says that actually one of the problems of contemporary philosophy is that it's too much tied to the individual thinkers. So people say Hillary Putnam in 1971 is not what Hillary Putnam thought in 1980 or whatever. And in order to avoid all of that, the theoretical framework is impersonal. Everybody can contribute to it.
Yeah, page 15 on that.
Yeah, and so he doesn't talk about himself, but here he talks about Taptoe's author. Taptoe, right, is towards the philosophical theory of everything. In Dutch, Taptoe is very strange, but it means a jamboree. It's like what they have every year in Edinburgh, where all these marching bands come.
Right.
That's called a Taptoe. It's just spelled the same way. So. This is a very, very strange example of
kind. You mean the military tattoo?
Military tattoo, is that what it's called? Yeah, tattoo, yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's called Taptoe. It's just spelled this way. Yeah. That's interesting. Is that the marching band? They can't also say that the only real music was marching music.
And we used to go year after year and to enjoy it.
Oh, really? When you did enjoy it?
Because after they finish, in the castle, in front of the castle, and after that they walk down the windmill and they clap their hands, and the buildings, stone buildings, and the road itself, and all these bands, when they finish marching down, and it's so beautiful, it really takes you out as well.
This
is on a hill as you're coming down. And it echoes.
Yeah, I've seen that once. But it's very militaristic.
Yeah.
Isn't it? Yeah. And that's. Yesterday I watched Keith Richards' documentary about Keith Richards, Under the Influence. You should really, if you have a chance, look, it's wonderful. At one point he says, he talks about rock and roll and how rock developed, and he said, yeah, rock and roll became, I like rock and roll. Rock and roll became rock in the early 70s. And what is rock? And you see him thinking, and he says, rock is marching music. Yeah. So rock and roll becomes, he says, the white man made rock and roll into marching music. And I like the roll. So I think that is, I thought that that was, from the point of view of philosophy of culture, somehow significant. just as this, the way in which he takes, obviously, also delight, not catalogical delight, but another sort, perhaps a little more darker delight, in recounting his experience in these administrative terms. Why in this book can't he just say, I saw the rainbow and it was amazing, or something like that? So there's something gained. There is the language itself tries to. There is a kind of, Zizek would say there's a perverse delight here in somehow. I don't know, but very good example.
What does he mean by catalogical delight?
Beauty.
Okay.
Experience of beauty. So that term, kalology, means the logos, the theory of what is kalos, what is beautiful. And it's actually from a book, that he mentions that, Kovac, I think,
who wrote an Nimoy book in 1974 in which he introduces this term chaology as a term that's better than aesthetics, because aesthetics refers to the theory of the senses, the aesthesis, the perception. That's what was used before Baumgarten made it into the name for the philosophical of art. And he says there is something that's not just about perception, it's not just about art, but it's about the experience of beauty. And that needs its own name. And that's why he calls this chronology. Yeah. And he tries to prove as a theory of general, as part of the general theory of being, that that being is beautiful, which is of course a very old idea. Being is in the medieval transcendental philosophy, which we'll look at in the course of the year. Being is one true and beautiful, and there are some other determinations. One of them is beautiful, one true, good, and beautiful. We'll have to talk more about it when we get into. I want to finish this, these seven theses. Yeah? So, truths are relative to a framework. Number four, within meta frameworks, apparently conflicting theoretical frameworks can be compared, and when comparison reveals the conflict to be genuine, ordered with respect to their theoretical adequacy. What is theoretical adequacy? So how would you order the experience with the...
What page was that?
26, number 4.
26?
Yeah.
Oh, I see, yeah.
TF4.
Yes.
Yeah?
So you say it's by relatively maximal coherence and intelligibility.
That's it, that's where
it's the criteria.
Yeah, this is where these criteria come, eh? Relatively maximal coherence and intelligibility. Such that relativity is both internal, the superior account is more coherent and intelligible than any other available concretization of its own framework, and external, the superior account is more coherent and intelligible than any concretizations of competing theoretical frameworks that are available. Okay. So that sounds easy, but what does that mean, for example, if we can think about that for a minute, for the sunrise and the heliocentric theory? How do you order that? What would be how does that work? We have a conflict. The sun rises. No, the sun doesn't rise. It's the earth that moves. That's an apparent conflict. And where do you go from there?
You'd have to kind of begin at a meta level, I suppose, and somehow work out why it's seen as a conflict.
Yeah.
Is it because of perception or senses or whatever?
Exactly. Why is it seen as a conflict? Mm. Well, it was a big conflict once. People were killed over it. So that doesn't define a conflict.
Yeah. Because of the framework that we're using. So if we have these two frameworks and think they are contrary to each other, but in the bigger picture of talking about being as both these frameworks, so they become that region within being, or perspectives within being.
So in this example, it's much more complex than it might first appear. It is not just the saying, it's not just the apparent conflict between saying the sun rises or the earth moves, because there is no real conflict between those two statements. They can both be true and they can both be false. it is the claim which is given with the claim that the Earth, that the Sun moves, and that's of course what we know from the stream of ideas. The claim is given with it is that that is the most important thing to say about the Sun. The Earth is central and the Sun moves around it. In other words, the centricity of the human being and the Earth. Did they lock us in now? Or? I thought we locked the door on the other side.
Well, there's a whole book to read, so.
It's thinking about being forever.
Yeah, it's like a Greek law. Oh my God. So there is a claim in the old theory of the Sun moving. There was not just a claim that it could never be the case that the Sun didn't move, but there's a much wider claim. It's a whole paradigmatic view of the cosmos implied in that claim. And that is the real source of the conflict. So you might say with that example, oh well, actually it turned out that this was an apparent conflict. So we don't have to order these two theoretical frameworks, Sunrise and 433, or we don't have to order them with respect to their theoretical adequacy, because they are actually not in conflict. Or you might say they are in conflict because the Sun doesn't rise at 4:33. So if I take that theoretical framework, the one that says that the Sun rises at 4:33, as having the same kind of cosmological implications or claims as the old one had, as the heliocentric. So if I take it as an astronomical theory, then it's not true, or then I would have to order it. I have to say no, it's not adequate.
I'm reminded slightly of Hegel's phenomenology of spirit, where we could say that two positions of Hegel are like they're kind of sublated, aren't they?
Yeah.
They're seen as an antithesis to each other.
Yeah.
But then a new standpoint is just a sublation of them. Okay. They still remain.
Yeah, they still retain certain validity, although it's more circumscribed where it is.
Yeah, and we're just at another level of
subconsciousness
and so on.
Yeah. But it treats, that's right, but then I think I'm still, I would say, yeah, but then you have already reduced the relation that I have to the world to that of the theoretical perspective. So that's not the point. The point of speaking of the sunrise isn't or wasn't or is not only that it is an astronomical theory about what happens to the Sun and the Earth in their relative position. So the moment you get to the question, which one of the theories is the most adequate, then you are already in the scientific frame of mind. And that's precisely what the theory of being is not about. I mean, it doesn't deny it. It doesn't say that we don't have science. We do, we use it for all sorts of things. But maybe you get around it by saying, yeah, okay, this is just an example, and you can really work it out in detail, all the implications of saying the Sun rises at 4:33. And some of it will be at the level of astronomical theorization, and there you can make an improvement. Some of it will be the level of a disclosure of being that retains the validity, even though the astronomical theory doesn't, that changes. It's very difficult to articulate it, but I'm trying to say that this is more difficult than it might seem at first. And if we're too easy with it, then we have already precluded all questioning, all thinking, because everything already appears as a theoretical framework as science would have them. Yeah.
Well, this could be both within the framework, theoretical framework he's talking about. They're both theories of aspects of being. They're not contradicting his thesis.
No, that's right. Yeah, exactly.
Doesn't commit him.
Sure, Yeah, of course. Yeah. So he may still get there.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's right. That's absolutely true. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Quickly. 5, 6, and 7. 5. Page 27 at the top. No human theoretician could ever establish that the framework they relied on was the best possible framework for any sufficiently complex subject matter, definitively including the subject matter of systematic philosophy. Establishing a framework is absolutely optimal would require identifying and comparing all of the infinitely many possible theoretical frameworks or families of frameworks for the relevant subject matter, and that for human beings is impossible. So in the conjunction of thesis 3, that all truths are relative theoretical frameworks, and thesis 5, that human beings can identify neither all such frameworks nor any optimal framework, it might appear to follow, but does not in fact follow, that there cannot be, or indeed that human beings cannot identify any absolute truths. The reason, this is not followed strictly by thesis 6. So, it is impossible for human beings to identify and compare all of the infinitely many possible theoretical frameworks, and therefore it is not possible to establish that a particular framework for any sufficiently complex subject matter would be definitive, including the subject matter of systematic philosophy. So that seems to me to hinge all on the fact that there are infinitely many possible theoretical frameworks. Why are there infinitely possible many theoretical frameworks? Because, I mean, there seems to be a kind of the idea behind this is that we can actually prove that TF5 is the case. It's not just a conjecture.
Well, because as many as you have theoreticians who come up with these frameworks and development of the particular sciences,
and
the development of frameworks, and you have so many of them, you can't claim with the absolute truth.
Yeah, but there's no, that's right.
Well, on the other hand, that doesn't follow from that there is no possibility of knowing some absolute truth.
No, that doesn't follow. We get to that in a minute, yeah. But what if we stop people from thinking, for example? Or we killed everyone until only 2 people left. And then...
So I would look from an objective point of view and say, being never stops revealing itself in different forms.
As
you said earlier about Descartes and Malebranche, that the world renews itself every moment.
So there is a kind of infinity is kind of built into it. Yeah. And even in language, the fact that language is also characterized by spontaneity, creativity, and infinity. So there is something about that. Yeah. But there is a kind of, as a Cartesian point, there is a kind of experience of infinity, awareness of infinity.
Otherwise, that would be all that happened, all that this is. So already there was.
Yeah.
And there's nothing new.
There's nothing new,
just a tolerable state to be.
Although Schopenhauer did seem to think that, I mean, he did say that it will never get any better than it is now, because otherwise that will already have happened.
Because time is infinite.
So it's not going to get any better. And it is not.
well, Nietzsche and Björn Wiedenhoff thought that the range of possibilities is limited.
Yeah,
there are certain combinations.
Yeah.
And then used it as justification for his eternal return.
Yeah, and here there's actually the implication that the possibilities are unlimited. So we can talk more about that, whether that's actually true or proven or, okay, but that doesn't mean, the fact that there's an unlimited number of theoretical, possible theoretical frameworks does not mean that there are no absolute truths. TF6. Absolute truths are truths that have identifiable versions in all theoretical frameworks. And then he says the most obvious such truth is the principle of non-contradiction. For no framework lacking a version of it as a component could qualify as a theoretical framework. The reason is that within such a framework, doesn't even deserve the name framework, no definitive truths whatsoever could emerge. And his footnote, determination that two distinct formulations situated in different theoretical frameworks qualified as versions of the principle of non-contradiction would require a reliance on a meta-framework considering both. The kind of reflexive condition. And then he says a clear consequence of TF5 is that the SSP cannot include the thesis that its own theoretical framework is the best possible for systematic philosophy. But it can't say TF7, the SSP's theoretical framework is the best that is currently available for systematic philosophy. And he builds that in as a kind of reflexive necessity. You have to have that claim. But that doesn't mean that the theory isn't changing all the time. But it's the orientation. He says in one respect it's highly ambitious, in another it's notably modest. So, but what about this? I saw you already sniggering at the non-contradiction thing.
Well,
yeah. So, well, where does that?
It wasn't necessarily that. I mean, I do think there's a problem with that, but I don't think I'm at a position yet where I can fully understand what that is. But it's also just the idea that, you know, it's too much of a quantitative magnitude, isn't it? It's, you can just add things and add things and add things without there being a qualitative shift in what it is.
Sorry, so you explain that again?
It's just too much based on a quantitative magnitude. Like, you know, with a spaceship,
yeah,
we just keep adding parts to it, but at some point it will no longer perhaps be a spaceship, or it will be a spaceship for different purposes.
Yeah, that's right.
There's no kind of, you know, and this is like Bloch and Hegel and Marx, there's no kind of qualitative leap. There's no like, you know, the baby being born, or if there's something, you know, it's...
Yeah. Yeah.
It just seems to be based on that idea that you can just permanently add to it,
yeah,
without it changing what it is.
What it is, yeah.
Which I find problematic. But the non-contradiction, I was just going to say, perhaps when we come to Eric Prisovaro, we can talk more about what he has to say about non-contradiction in that context, because Prisovaro has quite a long section on non-contradiction that's quite clear.
Good, we should definitely read that. That's a very good idea. Yeah.
Okay, well, it's got a long section on non-contradiction that's quite clear and well put, yeah.
I don't know why this, reading this paragraph, I thought of possible worlds. So, necessary truth, well, necessary being is a being that can be found in all possible worlds.
That's right.
But me as a possible being, I could be in some worlds, but not in all possible worlds.
Yeah, that doesn't make you for a contradiction.
Yeah, and I think the non-contradiction would be an element in every possible world.
Yeah.
But that SSP is not going to be in every possible world. So it could be true in some possible worlds.
Could it be a possible world in which the principle of non-contradiction did not apply?
According to certain cosmologists today, who kind of talk about a multiverse instead of a universe, from what I gathered from a documentary that I was watching, they'd probably say that that was possible.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, some interpretation of quantum physics would even say that it doesn't apply here. Yeah.
We do all the time believe and act according to possible worlds. Because if you don't have possible worlds, you can't act.
That's right. That's right. But I mean, but that's right. But in terms of non-contradiction.
Oh, right.
So. Even, it's important to realize that Hegel, of course, himself also acknowledged that non-contradiction holds. So he says contradictions are real, there are real contradictions in the world, and that's how the world moves. But it only moves because these contradictions cannot remain what they are. They must resolve themselves. Mm-hmm. And that is, in a way, a dialectical processual interpretation of the principle of non-contradiction. He doesn't say, as Aristotle would say, that classical formulation of the principle of non-contradiction, something cannot be true and false in the same respect at the same time, something like that. So he doesn't have it in a static way. He says you can have a self-contradictory entity, and in fact all entities carry the negation within them. But that only means that things are in movement and process until such a time where the absolute has already happened, etc. But again, when all gets resolved in absolute being. So it's not the case that a dialectical theory that would emphasize the reality of contradictions, of real existing contradictions, would be in violation of the principle of non-contradiction. It gets more difficult, I think, with certain aspects of theory of being that we would normally call mystical. So in the kind of mystical realizations where paradoxical ways of speaking, all things are one and many at the same time in the same respect, where these kinds of statements seem to be necessary to articulate a certain aspect of the theory of being or the experience of being, that the principle of non-contradiction becomes problematic. If we were to say that if we have an adequate formulation of the theory of being, then we might get into a position where we have to say such things as the subject is a predicate and the predicate is the subject, or being is one and being is many at the same time, or being is substance and being is relation at the same time, and then love is hate, hate is love, that's all kind of cop is a criminal, that's all these things, they might have a kind of, there might be a truth status to them that the systematic structural philosophy has to acknowledge as well. And then you might have this is an important point. And maybe it's actually quite related to this point of what is the theoretical status of poetical discourse. I think there's kind of, there you would also say that in poetry, not every poem, but there is a lot of poetry that uses paradox contradiction, say something that is nevertheless meaningful. But simply by italicizing the word theoretical may not be enough. That's what he does here. He says, well, if it doesn't have the principle of non-contradiction, it's not a theoretical framework. Maybe it's another kind of framework, but contradiction makes something non-theoretical. Okay, it's 5 minutes past 12, so we have to stop.
What with the theoretical framework? Itself alters the truths within it, like say, in a contradiction.
Yeah.
And then, like Hegel's point, he would recognize the and Kant before him, so the antinomies. But Kant thought you can't make something out of them, the other stay as they are, because there's a way of looking at them.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And you still have them.
Yeah.
But Hegel thought you can go too high.
You can resolve it.
Right.
Exactly. Yeah. So there's a more of an adherence to actually to a faith in the principle of
consideration. The framework here.
Is that not Bloch's philosophy?
Bloch too, yeah.
Is hope just not for non-contradiction?
Yeah, I guess you could say that, yeah.
Maybe. Because I like the ways that Hegel's philosophy is dialectical, processual, unfolding. Whereas Bloch's is just the same, but without the guarantee.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's absolutely true. Yeah, so it's a hope of a non-contradiction. So next time, I want to we'll talk about the rest of the book. But of course, it's a big book. I would like specifically to talk about chapter 5: theoreticity, practicity, and affectivity. Number 6, human freedom, And briefly number 7, but then especially also number 8, because that's where the theory of being is presented, and that's, I think, the central aspect for us. But we have to also look at theoretical practice, the acceptivity and human freedom at least. So if you could prepare that, as we have done today, that would be great. And then next week I will also bring for you a photocopy of that long chapter 2 from Being and God, in which Punto analyzes Heidegger's treatment of the science fire, the question of being, and gives his critique of that. So we'll read that for the week after, probably 2 weeks, it's about 100 pages. But I'll make photocopies of that and bring and give that to you next week.
Thank you very much.
Yeah?